We're very lucky today to not only have this beautiful space, but also to have a top-notch, world-class speaker here with us. Dr. Tim Barber is here to speak with us today. He is a principal scientist in the Burton, Ohio office of Environ International Corporation. He has more than 25 years of experience in environmental chemistry, ecotoxicology, and risk assessment. Tim holds a doctorate in marine science from the University of South Florida and a bachelor of science in chemistry from Binghamton University. He has published more than 30 papers in peer-reviewed literature, and recently presented his research using ecosystem services to support the green redevelopment of abandoned industrial sites in urban environments at the Society of Ecological Restoration Conference in Madison, Wisconsin. In 2013, Tim and his team at Environ estimated the value of ecosystem services and other economic benefits from the properties owned and or managed by the Geauga Park District properties. The results of this study will be presented along with some discussion of how they quantify the value of ecosystem services from parks and preserved lands in Ohio. Please welcome Dr. Tim Barber.
If it's okay, I mean, I'm assuming everyone can hear me. No, usually has trouble hearing me. So I'll go without it if I can. The one AV issue that I'm having is advancing the slides, so I'm trying to do it with my Bluetooth mouse. So maybe it works, maybe it doesn't, so we may have to have somebody hit page down.
I can do that.
Thank you. A couple of years ago, I approached Tom Curtin, who was then the executive director, and talked to him about ecosystem services. He was very familiar with the concept and certainly appreciated my offer to do a pro bono project for free to the parks to quantify ecosystem services. It was clear at the time that there was a movement afoot to sort of assault the value of the park district, and I felt that was wrong, and I felt that quantifying ecosystem services would be very helpful to the park to demonstrate the value of what the park district offers the people of Geauga County as well as other folks in other counties as well. When people from other counties come into Geauga County to enjoy the parks, that's called tourism. Which is not a bad thing, and we like when they spend money in Geauga County. And there's so many things in Geauga County, especially in the natural world, to take advantage of. That's why people often come here to enjoy the great outdoors. Ecosystem services, the concept of the natural world being beautiful has been known forever. Since the first person, I'm sure, was enjoying nature. But the concept that there is value there, that nature is providing certain services to humans, has a value. And that value is not traded in the marketplace, typically. So it's difficult to monetize, to put a dollar amount on it. But there's no way that you can assume that the natural world does not provide those benefits. Things like stormwater management, we'll talk about. Things like erosion, soil control. Things like water purification, all incredibly important for us in our lives, provided by nature, but we don't pay for it. But there still is value that comes from those services. One of the first people from the Sand County Almanac, if I'm sure many of you have read it, a terrific book, 1949 or so. Although Leopold was, you know, really one of these first people that really started talking about the value of nature to And again, when we see it as a community to which we belong, we may begin to use it with love and respect, but it has to be respected. If it is altered, if it is destroyed, those services go away and can have profound impact to humans on an economic scale as well as on a spiritual well-being. Okay, this is my first Ronald Reagan quote in a presentation, so I hope you enjoy it. Certainly, there is a political component to this issue in Geauga. I don't know why there's a political component to it. It doesn't make sense to me. It seems like both sides, both parties, all people benefit by nature, and I'm not sure why there is this assault on the Park District here, and I think our President Reagan could have said it better. It's not a liberal issue. It's not a conservative issue. It's just common sense. And hopefully this talk will show you the value of nature, how it can be quantified in terms of a metric that really everyone understands, which is the dollar. So first, you know, some definitions just to make sure everyone's kind of on the same page. An ecosystem is a coexisting set of species and habitat, physical habitat. There will be different species in woodlands, different species in an emergent wetland. So it depends on kind of the physical habitat will determine what kind of species are there. And it also depends, obviously, on the climatic region. So Everglades National Park has a different ecosystem than, for instance, urban wetlands. Ecosystem processes, that's the sort of interaction between the biology, the physical environment, and the chemical world. So how nutrients are processed, how organic matter is fixed, carbon is fixed by photosynthesis, how that energy is transferred into different organisms and ultimately providing food for those organisms. So that's all kind of the ecosystem processes that are that interaction and that trophic transfer, that transfer along the food web. Examples, of course, photosynthesis, are herbivory, deer, for instance, are herbivores. Predation by animals, so meat-eater animals are consuming wildlife to satisfy their energy needs. Decomposition of bacteria, so taking that organic matter and turning it back into nutrients that can be used by plants to fix more carbon. So it's a cycle. If that cycle is left alone, it's going to be very productive. If it's altered, if things are taken away from it by human development and other causes, then the ecosystem will collapse. Ecosystem services. This is, as I said, started being discussed in the late 40s. Academia, the universities and colleges have talked about ecosystem services for many, many decades and really trying to understand what the value is of these ecosystem services. And now we see firms like mine, consulting firms that work for industry primarily, are starting to take some of these concepts and starting to appreciate the importance of ecosystem services. Some examples, freshwater supply, and I'll talk about that in a little more. Climate regulation, again, you know, if you're in downtown Cleveland, it's going to be that heat island effect because of the asphalt and all the development. If you come out to Geauga County, you're going to have a much cooler environment because of the way the nature is interacting with sunlight, for example, and temperature. Also good for science and education, so we have a lot of natural programs where elementary school students are coming to the parks to learn about various things. And of course, you know, one of the most important from my perspective and one of the most difficult to really quantify, especially in terms of dollars, is this concept of spiritual well-being. So when you're out in nature and it's quiet, beautiful, there's just something about it that affects, I think, all of us. And that's very difficult to quantify, but it's impossible to refute. It is a fact, it is true, but what is the value of that? It's a little more challenging. If it's not there, then I think we all appreciate that, what we had when we had it. So when you look at these ecosystem services, you see something like soil retention, and you go, soil retention, I guess so, but how important can that be? How valuable can that be? Well, look back at Grapes of Wrath and Steinbeck and the Dust Bowl in the 30s. I mean, it was the biggest, perhaps, until maybe the Gulf of Mexico a few years ago, ecological catastrophe that occurred in America. It was huge. It was devastating. The government, in today's values, spent billions and billions and billions of dollars trying to fix it. The cause was obviously the economic collapse, which was both in America and worldwide. Farmers getting less money for every bushel of their product. So the answer in their mind was plant more. If you're not getting enough money per bushel, then get 10 more bushels, and you'll be able to have that same level of income. It was kind of this cycle, and what happened is they basically cultivated all the grassland. Then there was a drought, and just kind of a natural occurrence, but there's no longer any grass cover, so we just had the Dust Bowl. All of the topsoil that the agricultural community and the rest of the country relied on in the breadbasket of the country was suddenly gone. That soil just blew off and was no longer available, and it was a very significant catastrophe, because now the part of the country that was providing the wheat, the grain, all that agricultural products was gone, and we had a threatened food supply because of it. So if you look at the million acres that was affected, the billions of dollars that went into fixing it, it's like $1,000 an acre. So that's one way avoidance cost. If to avoid that issue, if we had paid so much per acre to farmers for not cultivating, that would have been kind of one way to value this service. Another one, delicious, huh? What if you lived in Toledo? And suddenly, you could not turn on your water faucet and have clean water. It's crazy in my mind. It's like a third world country all of a sudden. The people in Toledo do not have a secure source of fresh water. And that's ecosystem services. There was the Great Black Swamp that was about 1 million acres, 980,000 or so acres, completely removed and used for farmland. That swamp was purifying that water going into Lake Erie. It's a very shallow part of Lake Erie, so it's very sensitive to changes. All of a sudden, you're putting too many nutrients in it, and you get these harmful algal blooms. Well, what's that worth? How much is the dollar amount worth of that water purification service? Well, people in Ohio and certainly in Toledo now know. Billions and billions of infrastructure dollars are going to be spent trying to fix it. They have to come up with new water treatment plants. Not wastewater treatment plants, although it's a lot like a wastewater treatment plant, but a water treatment plant just to be able to engineer clean water. It's going to cost billions of dollars. Because the wetlands will be moved so we could have more cultivation. Because the concept was, okay, if you get a bushel of soybeans or corn, that's money. We get that. The water purification services provided by that wetland, I don't really understand it. It's not traded on the marketplace. Therefore, it has no value. Let's plow some more fields and plant some more crops. Well, it's coming back to roost now, and it is billions of dollars. So here we're looking at kind of the valuation of ecosystem services. Again, I mentioned earlier, they're not traded in the marketplace. If you knew what a soil retention credit was and you could pay for it, then all of a sudden, you know, you can kind of understand it. People are talking about carbon credits, where you're trying to slow the effect of changing the composition of the atmosphere with respect to carbon dioxide, so there's carbon credits. Well, that's attempting to trade things in a marketplace that really are non-market services. So that's one way to create a valuation system. And one of the ways that, you know, I talked to Tom when we were starting this process is, once you have a tool like this, once you have a framework like this, then all of a sudden you can start using it to make decisions. Does it make sense to buy this property? Does it make sense to convert some of this property into a different use? You can start looking at trade-offs because, like it or not, a metric that we all understand is dollars and cents. You know, and there's a kind of a yuckiness to that concept of trading the natural world in terms of dollars. And there's ethical concerns about that. But, you know, in my opinion, you know, we got to get real. People understand dollars. And when we start putting the value of the parks in terms of dollars, I would love if it wasn't necessary. But all of a sudden, it's a common metric that everyone can understand. So here's a chief science of the Nature Conservancy, and started looking at really understanding that kind of full accounting system, decisions made, you know, for the short-term benefit, more agricultural land can have profound economic consequences in the future, as the folks in Toledo are understanding. So this concept of putting a dollar value, despite its ethical concerns, to nature has certainly gained a lot of support. As far as kind of the applications of ecosystem services, you know, I tried to use as small a font as possible so you couldn't read this too well. The real key on this slide is not these applications. There's lots of them and there'd be many more. But it's really looking at these. Coca-Cola, Weyerhaeuser, Rio Tinto, BP, Shell, Disney, Dow, ExxonMobil, American Electric Power. I mean, these are the major corporations, not only in America, but the world. They're getting it. They understand how important nature is. One of the big liabilities facing industry, manufacturing facilities, of that sort of built infrastructure, stormwater management. When you look at the city of Cleveland, they're going to be spending billions of dollars, it's all still in litigation, they're going to be spending billions of dollars not to pump so much stormwater into Lake Erie. Because the problem is, it's not just stormwater. It's mixed sewer and stormwater, combined sewer overflows. So when it rains, all that water goes into the sewer system and raw sewage goes into Lake Erie. I don't like that. That's not good. So in order to fix that, they're building these huge underground tunnels, billions of dollars, to hold that water so then when it stops raining, they can start trickling it into the wastewater treatment plant to prevent those sewer overflows. So the infrastructure of this country is very old and at risk, and combined sewer overflows is one of the main things. I mean, it's mind-boggling to me when I open up the plane dealer and I'm looking at fecal coliform counts on beaches in Lake Erie. Well, geez, that's only 4,000 per milliliter. Is that good? Is that bad? I would just soon not have any fecal coliform counts in Lake Erie. So, you know, you're kind of going, how much poop in the water am I going to be okay with? You know, and they have it, and it's quantified. It's numbers, you know, and the numbers are per milliliter, so I'm not really sure what that means, but it's not good. And that's kind of taking away all of the money that would be spent by people going to the beach. My favorite story in Cleveland is when I first moved here in 1995, went downtown to visit a client, law firm, and it was the Holiday Inn. And the Holiday Inn, you know, was located right on Lake Erie. And behind it was a parking lot. And I'm looking at it, I'm going, well, good, then no one can see Lake Erie. I mean, how twisted is that? That a developer thinks nobody's going to want to see Lake Erie from this hotel. They would rather look at a parking garage. I mean, how wrong is that? And that is kind of how far nature has been stepped on, and we really need to start looking at those benefits because they are really significant economic benefits. There's lots of ways to look at these services that aren't traded in the marketplace. We have lots of natural resource economists at Environ, and they do these studies. They're expensive. Just like the survey ongoing, you develop a survey tool, kind of the survey. You test the survey tool with a random population. You look at those results. You look at how people might be struggling with certain questions. So you revise those questions. And then you go back out to a very, you know, representative population to try to, you know, conduct a survey that is scientifically valid. That's very expensive. Lots of surveys have been done on the services provided by nature, and we can take advantage of those. Avoidance cost. You know, one of the things I talked about, you know, if we didn't get rid of Great Black Swamp in Toledo, in northwest Ohio, we wouldn't have had to spend the $2.5 billion that we're going to be spending over the next 5 years. So that's a way to value that, the social services as well. Hedonic pricing is, you know, the real estate market. If you have a home next to a beautiful park, it's not going to be developed ever. That value of that property is going to be worth more if everything else is accounted for. I mean, bedroom, square footage, year built, type of roof, all those things. You account for all those things, and you'll find out that houses near natural areas are worth more than houses that are not. So that's hedonic pricing. So there's lots of those tools. So when we're trying to look at the Park Service, you know, as I said, we did this project for free, and you know, I was happy to do that, and my company was very supportive of that. If we went out and did a primary survey, it would have been hundreds of thousands of dollars, and my company would not have been happy about that. So the tool that we use is benefit transfer. So you look at other natural areas, you account for differences between the area that the study occurred and the area that you're interested in, and you transfer those benefits. So you're letting someone else spend a lot of money, do the heavy lifting, to come up with the valuation estimates, and then you're applying it to your site. It's done all the time, and there's uncertainty associated with that, obviously, but if there's enough studies out there that you can select the right ones that are representative of the same type of ecosystem, same types of physical habitats, same type of climatic region, then all of a sudden, you know, you can have a pretty good idea of the value of your park, and you can do that very cost effectively. So how we looked at it, again, we have the natural resources, we have all these services, provisioning services. Those are ones that are traded in the marketplaces. I mean, you could go in and you could clear cut a forest, you could cut up all the logs into 16 inches, you could split them, stack them, measure them out on a per cord basis, and come up with the value of that area. So that's one provisioning service, fiberboard. You can also look at water supply. So 300,000 or so people in Akron are getting the drinking water from Geauga County. They're paying for their drinking water. That would be another way to value that service. We did not look at provisioning services in this effort. We did not look at consumptive use, where something was taken from a natural area and was no longer available for the next person. We ignored that in our treatment of all the values that we're going to be talking about. Regulating services, water purification, soil retention, we talked about those. Pollination, maybe not a big deal here, but it's a big, big, big deal in the world. So concerns about neonicotinoid pesticides, concern about colony collapse disorder. Honeybees, it turns out, are quite important for the food supply for America. There are people that get paid hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars. The whole industry is probably a multi-million dollar industry where they take their hives, put them in trucks, take them to different agricultural places, and let their bees pollinate their crop because there ain't no more bees in that area to pollinate those crops. So they're essentially pollinating for hire because that service is gone in that area. It's a significant issue. And again, you think of pollination. That just happens, doesn't it? Wind blows, pollination. We don't have to worry about it. We have to worry about it now. And of course, you know, ecological services just for the benefit of the food web and organisms that live there. And cultural services are very important. Aesthetic, you know, when you drive over the Duke Reservoir and you look at the large open water, you know, I really like that drive. I really like looking at open water. I like looking at the ocean. I like looking at Lake Erie. There's value there. Bird watching, and again, that spiritual well-being thing. So all of these things sort of fit in to what we call ecosystem services. And we have kind of consumptive uses, which we're not considering. And we also have ecological services. And then we also have human use services. So people that are getting recreational opportunities in those natural areas. And we'll talk about that as well. So one of the first sort of major efforts by academia, Bob Cassans is no longer at Vermont, but this is when he was there. He published a paper in 1997. I'm sorry, I'm in your way here. 1997, it wasn't so much a defensible scientific study as it was making a point, because he tried to do something so ambitious, and he had all the leaders in the world on this paper. So ambitious. What are the ecosystem services in the entire world? And think about it, you know, the fisheries, the shrimp in the Gulf of Mexico, you know, tuna in the open ocean, all of these sort of services that are responsive, that are for humans. Humans benefit by those, water purification, soil retention, but it's provided by nature. He did it, and it turns out about $33 trillion per year, which is very close to the gross domestic product of the entire world. So the benefits of nature is about what our total economic engine is in the world. Makes perfect sense to me. I mean, how are we sort of generating economic value? We're taking things, we're building things, we're selling things. That's the economic engine, and it's in large part, if not totally, derived from nature. Natural Resource Council. So this is the National Academy of Science. You may not agree with them, but they're the best scientists in the country. And they came in and addressed this issue of ecosystem services. So this was in about 2004. So it's no longer something you see in maybe esoteric academic publications and journals that, you know, 99.99% of the world never read. But this is really the top scientists getting together and sort of starting to understand this process. This is also in 2005, Millennium Ecosystem Assessment. This was much more of a global effort. They started to develop that framework of how we can do this on a practical basis, starting to define some of the terms, starting to pull together all the data that's out there, that's been published in journals, reviewing it, making sure it had appropriate quality associated with those estimations, and then sort of compiling it in a, I think, four-volume publication. So very important to really be able to start having people like me conduct these sorts of assessments. 2007, we had the UK put a paper out, a report out. What's really interesting is in the US EPA, Environmental Protection Agency, in this country is moving towards that as well, is all of a sudden the UK, you can imagine, it's an island, there's only so much land out there, it's very different. Europeans treat the environment very differently than we do. And there's a reason why. We have a lot of open, undeveloped space. You know, our challenges of old industrial property, turning them back into productive areas and properties that can be used again, why? I just go out and do a green space. You know, all I got to do is just go out on the bypass, and there's land all over the place that's never been used. Why am I going to go into a city, try to clean up some legacy contamination associated with an industrial process 100 years ago? That's expensive. Why would I do that? I'm going to go out to green space. Well, in Europe, they don't have that advantage. They don't have that ability. It is what it is, and they have to take advantage of everything. In Germany, they no longer have landfills. They're really doing waste to energy, recycling, because they don't have room for more landfills. We seem to have an endless supply of room for landfills. We'll just build another one. You know, so it's very different in a land-rich environment in the United States than in the UK. So the UK all of a sudden started looking at ecosystem services in their entire regulatory program. You want to register a new pesticide, you have to look at ecosystem services. You want to clean up a property, you have to look at ecosystem services. You want to build a new waterfront development, you have to look at ecosystem services. A much more holistic approach, trying to look at how nature and humans interact to make sure that we're not having a short-term benefit and a long-term detriment. Just like in Toledo, now they're paying the price for that lack of consideration of ecosystem services 100 years ago, 200 years ago, when they were sort of developing that area. EPA is getting into it as well in 2009. So looking at how different methods should be used, recommending an approach to do this. So, you know, the scientific community had these concepts for many years, and now the regulations, the regulatory agencies, are starting to put together frameworks of how those should come together and work. President's Council of Advisors. You can remember this was controversial back in George H.W. Bush days, and I'm not sure it's quite as controversial now, but it was every law had to have a cost-benefit analysis. So you couldn't pass a law in Congress without an economic analysis saying this is the cost, these are the benefits. So Clean Air Act, increasing Clean Air Act regulations on industry versus the benefits of reducing haze and not being able to see across the Grand Canyon, things like that, had to be sort of considered. And back in those days, the aesthetic value of the Grand Canyon was not considered. It was really, well, you know, we're going to have this benefit, you know, less asthma, less lung cancer, all those effects associated with better air quality, versus how much cost industry has to do to put scrubbers on their coal plants. So that was the cost-benefit analysis. Now, in 2011, you still have to do a cost-benefit analysis for everything, but that analysis has to include everything. So it has to include those natural services, those services provided by nature to humans, has to be considered in the regulatory framework. 2013 is when we finally put out our report, where we went through kind of a very systematic process. So we used our GIS, which is Geographic Information System. So if you go on the county auditor's website, you can see the map of Geauga County. You can see who owns what parcels. So you can identify the footprint, if you will, of all the parcels owned and managed by Geauga. So that's very important. We're looking at nature, so we have to identify the properties that are included in the partnership. Then we looked at habitat. So one could go to each and every park, the little handheld GPS unit, and map out every wetland, map out every forest, map out every open water, lake, pond. That would be very expensive. So what we did is we relied on satellite imagery and land cover maps created by, in this case, I think it was NOAA, National Oceanic Atmospheric Administration. So we had a land cover map that was available in GIS. So now all of a sudden we know the properties, we know the habitat types on those properties to a certain level of a certain degree of accuracy, because it is a satellite imagery. And then we go into the literature and do this benefit transfer, so we know the value of each acre and what kind of ecosystem services are, and we look through those and we make sure they're appropriate for our sites. And then we'll estimate the total value of our properties. So again, you know, looking at land area, 400 square miles in Geauga County, compared to the state and the United States, population around 100,000. Per capita income, I always find this fascinating, $33,000 per person. So it times the total number of people, and you can come up with kind of the gross domestic product, if you will, of Geauga County. Second richest county in the state of Ohio. Second richest. Surprises me. facilities. It is a wealthy county compared to most of the state. That's a huge, huge benefit, and it tells us how important the economy is in Geauga County. So again, most of you know this, I'm sure better than I, Park District established in 61. Landholding is more than 9,000 acres. So I'll try to deal in acres mostly, but it's, you know, over 9,000 acres that are owned and managed by the Park District. So again, 14 square miles compared to 400, you know, is not a very large percentage of the entire county. Relatively modest. What are the amenities? It's hiking trails, biking trails, equestrian trails, picnic areas, nature centers, canoe, kayak launches, and there are areas open for hunting and fishing. So really, a lot of activities to draw people into. Talked about using this land cover that was provided by satellite imagery. Here's the challenge. It's plus or minus 30 meters. So that's 900 feet. Almost 100 feet. So, you know, when you're looking at on the scale of the county, that's good enough. It was very easy to pull this information in and to use it. But again, that's a uncertainty because, you know, plus or minus 100 feet is good for a first cut. But again, that's the kind of improvement that you could make by going in and looking at the properties with more specificity. So this, again, is hard to see, but Geauga County, and all the areas, if you can see them, are areas owned and managed by the Park District. So to look at it in a little more detail, you can see kind of pixelation or kind of the staircase approach. That's that plus or minus 30 meter issue. So instead of it being a smooth, if it was plus or minus a meter, for instance, it would be a little smoother, but this still gives us a lot of information and enough to move forward with our study. Burton Wetlands, my favorite park. If you look at all the acres and then you look at kind of the different habitats that come up. So there's some areas that are developed. Developed areas are buildings, roads, parking lots, developed areas. Relatively small, and what I'm often confused by in the debate here is why does developed equal recreation?
Doesn't make any sense.
Are you recreating on a parking lot? If you build more parking lots, is there more recreation? It's just does not make sense, and that's really part of the problem. So hopefully this kind of an analysis will be available and people can look at it and understand that nature is why people are going there to recreate, not the parking lots, not the roads, not, you know, buildings. In some cases, buildings provide a lot of nice amenities, but, you know, that's not really what's drawing people in. There's some areas of the park that are managed for agriculture. People are leasing those areas and growing crops on it. There's wetlands. Wetlands are obviously very important for nature. Open water, there's lakes. A lot of it's forested. There's some grassland as well. And shrubland is really kind of that successional transition between grassland and forest. So small trees. You know, if you've left it alone for another 30, 50 years, then a lot of that shrubland would be moved into the forest. So here now I'm looking at all of those studies that are available in the literature, and they were compiled by many people, but we're using DeGroote and many, many, many others on that paper. I think it was about 20, 30 authors on that paper. They really went out and did an analysis of the literature. They pulled together all the studies. They looked at what they did. They removed ones that they didn't think were appropriate, and got a very large database that's searchable by people like me. I can download it, I can search it, I can apply it to the areas in Geauga County, and then I can use that information. It's basically dollars per acre. So you can kind of see, you know, the value of ecosystems, wetlands, you know, there's a range here. It's not like one value everywhere. There's a range. There's different quality wetlands. So there's a range. And then we move up into rivers, open water, forest, and shrublands. And then you can see, you know, grasslands, again, has a bigger range than some of these other ones. But that is a really lesser value. So from an ecosystem perspective, less animals using grasslands. But again, you know, going back into the Great Plains and the Dust Bowl, you know, grasslands can be extraordinarily important as well. What we looked at is kind of a central tendency, which is kind of the middle estimate. And then we looked at the 75th, which is this part of the box, and the 25th and the 75th percentile. So again, we're getting a range to reflect the obvious uncertainty in the benefit transfer process. So when you put the habitats together, you put the value estimates together, you multiply those two and you come up with dollars. So we have about 8,800 acres of natural areas in the park district. Central tendency is about $15.8 million per acre per year. Significant number. And if you look at kind of the low end and high end estimate, we want to make sure that the true value is somewhere in between there. That's between about $10 and $20 million. This is services provided by nature to people in a metric that's US dollars. We also look at recreation, and one of the things Ed was talking about is kind of how does recreation fit into that? Well, there is some recreation that's extraordinarily tied to nature. For instance, walking on a trail, bird watching, nature photography, all things that are intimately dependent upon nature. So those are the things we're trying to capture. We talked about education, so Park Service having rangers go out and students come into the parks to be educated on various parts of nature, various programs that are being conducted. People that are just visiting the park and going to the park to do some of those activities. So that's kind of, you know, things that we're looking at. And again, in a benefit transfer approach, there's a wonderful database, Rosenberger's database of recreational values, determined by a variety of economic methods published in the peer-reviewed literature, you know, sorted by different categories. We can kind of look at the activities that are available in each park and figure out about what the value is per user day. So it's dollar per user per day. So we have routine park visits by car count. So the rangers were nice enough over a few week period of time when they were visiting each park to do their security rounds would just kind of keep track of how many cars that were there. Special events, these numbers are probably very, very accurate because they keep track of when everyone goes out there. So if you're going out to a park to look at a, hopefully a kind of a nighttime a meteor display, hopefully, if it happens. They keep track of how many people are there. Total visits is adding those up. This is done by how many cars times about the average number of people per car, which is about 2.8 or so. You come up with taking a average value of a user day, which is, I don't know, I think it was around $25 or so. You come up with about $18 million. So this is based on user days. So these are values based on number of people per day that they're in the park doing activities that are for and involved with nature. And again, we've attempted to put in kind of an estimate between 12.5 and say $25 million. So another pretty big number, roughly on the same order of magnitude as the ecological services provided. So again, you know, we looked at the benefit transfer approach, differences between the primary studies, applying it to Geauga County, there's some uncertainty there. We feel that plus or minus 40% is a pretty good estimate of that uncertainty, so the true answer is between those ranges. We're estimating around $34 million of ecosystem services per year for the parks. So that is not consumptive use. So we're not valuing how much corn is grown on a parcel that's leased by the park district. We're not looking at firewood, or we're not looking at other extractive uses. We're looking at just sort of ecological services and human use services that are intimately tied to the natural environment of the park district properties. $34 million per year. There's other benefits to this, and we attempted to quantify where we could some of these other benefits. So again, we talked about if your property is located next to a park, there's roughly, you know, I think it was about an 8% increase in property value. So if you look at, you know, 10, 15 studies that have been published in different areas, they're coming up with a number that's around 8%. So factor in all the other things, bedrooms, square footage, amenities inside your house, property, parcel size, it's about an 8% increase, all else being equal, just because you're next to a park where that land is preserved and it will not be built upon in the future. Very important for consumers when they're buying a house. So that adds a lot of property value. So that influence is larger than we assumed it was. So it's several thousand feet near a park. We only went into the auditor's website and looked at residential, single-family residential properties that were immediately adjacent to, shared a border with a park. Those are the only properties we considered, grossly underestimating probably the true value of this. That is almost $7 million more of property value in Geauga County just because of the Geauga County Park Districts. Now, if you look at something based on an average property tax rate of 1.65%, which is pretty reasonable compared to many other parts of the country, Shaker, for instance, that's about $114,000 of revenue into Geauga County government year after year after year after year, just because there's houses next to parks and those houses are worth more. Then we're also looking at, you know, kind of the money. So we're talking about here of, you know, certainly you can imagine at Westwoods, people go in and buy stuff. So it might be out of county, might be in the county, but their money is still U.S. dollars. And that influences the economy in Geauga County, whether it's ecotourism or whatever you want to call it. That is a direct economical stimulus to the county, people being drawn in and spending money in our parks. Also, the local jobs, about 83 local jobs created because of the park district. That may be people working for the park, that may be other people who are involved in somehow selling things to the park. So 83 jobs is associated with the park district. $4.5 million, and again, because there's some cycling of that revenue, it's about $5.1 million contribution to the local gross domestic product of the county. Significant, significant number. You know, we can talk about the salaries of the park personnel. Personally, I don't think they're very high, but they're not taking their money and putting it in the Cayman Islands. They're not taking their money and putting it offshore to pay less taxes. They're paying taxes and they're spending probably almost every cent that they make. That goes back into the Geauga County economy, fuels the economy. So when we talk about how much money is being spent by the park district, we act like it's a closed system and that money just going somewhere. You don't know where, down the toilet maybe. I don't know. It's not. It's cycling. It's going back into the economy. We're benefiting by the workers spending money that they make as county employees working for the park district. That money benefits everyone because it benefits our economy. The simple common sense is, Ronald Reagan says, and it's basic economics. Basic economics. Just confuses me why that's such a difficult concept for many to understand. Other direct impacts that I did not quantify, but I'm going to show you some examples of some other parks that did quantify this. So we're looking at things like health benefits. People getting up, people riding their bike on trails, they're healthier, both mentally and physically. They spend less money on health care. That saves money. There's been lots of studies to document that. I did not quantify that for this study, but some others have. This, to me, is really an important point, and I would have loved to have more time to understand this better. One thinks if they took away a park, much like this one, and put a bunch of one-acre lots on it, put a bunch of residential homes on it, I mean, think about it. It would generate a huge amount of property tax. That would be great, wouldn't it? No, because the amount of money spent by the municipality to support that kind of dense residential community is about $1.20 for every dollar raised by property tax. It's upside down. What is really helpful is undeveloped land, because there is no sewer systems, water systems, roads, snow plowing. There's very little government services that are required to maintain undeveloped land, of course. So it's about, for every dollar raised by undeveloped land, it takes about 30 cents or so to maintain it. So it's a net gain. So money raised by undeveloped land is going in to support people who have homes starting in the fives or fours or whatever homes start nowadays. So this is really, really an important. More development may seem like a short-term benefit by additional property value. That's wrong. And it's clearly wrong. It's been demonstrated over and over and over again. And for somebody who lives in Burton Village, you understand what infrastructure, old, decaying infrastructure is all about. You know, it's like I know the people in the village when they call the office, we have a water main break. East of the gas station, you're not going to have any water today. I don't have water today? Seems like a problem, you know? And it's huge infrastructure. Imagine if Burton Village would get all their water pipes, sewer water treatment plant up to, you know, 2015 standards. Phenomenal cost. It's just not going to happen. We got duct tape and coat hangers in Burton Village. So here's an attempt. So this is another sort of ethical concern that I want to point out. It will take me a minute, but let me try to walk through. So I'm looking at all kind of the services, the values of these different categories of economic benefits. And I'm projecting them out, I think, 20 years. So kind of a lifespan of 11, let's say. And we're discounting it. You know, it's not the same value. And that social discount rate is, you know, would you take a dollar today or a dollar next year? I take a dollar today, thanks. Would you take a dollar today or $5 next year? I'll wait around and not take the $5. That kind of analysis is how economics look at net present value. So they're relating economic dollars to, in this case, 2012, but in 2015 terms. So you got to use that discount rate. Many people in this field think this is unethical. Oh, I'm sorry, grandkids. Nature just isn't worth as much to me now as it will be for you. That's what you're saying. You're saying the value of nature 20 years from now isn't as good as it is right now. Aren't we trying to save nature for grandchildren? Or maybe even our great-grandchildren if we're so lucky to have them. I mean, that's what nature's all about, is preserving that for future generations. And here is this classic economic approach of discount rate that's eroding those values. But the value of nature itself is not eroded. I would make the argument that all these curves should be going up. It's more valuable in the future. Ask the people in Toledo, you know, 20 years ago, they did this analysis, what the value of nature is today versus 20 years ago. It would be worth more than it was then. Because now they can't get a glass of drink. So again, when you look at this kind of, even very conservative, that is, we're lowballing the estimate, we're being very modest, $80 million. I'm sorry, $500 million and $80 million of other economic benefits. Almost $600 million of benefits in terms of dollars for the Park District over 20 years. That seems like real money, you know? Million here, million there, pretty soon it's real money. So now we're going to go through these pretty quick, and I'm not sure how I am on time. Is time okay? Or no football on, Pro Bowl. We're quick, not worried about that. So Cleveland Metro Parks did a study in 2011. They only looked at certain categories. Came up with an average annual estimate of almost $200 million. Obviously, Metro Parks is a lot bigger. Our number, remember, is around 34. You know, so if you start normalizing to area and look at, you know, just certain things that they looked at, they did quantify health benefits. They also have golf courses as part of Metro Parks as well. Then we also have Bowling Green and Sea Grant working on the bird watching along Lake Erie. Very specific geographic area, just certain Lake Erie, you know, just coastline of Lake Erie. People that are doing nothing but going to Lake Erie to watch birds and spending money. I forget that. They're spending money as they're watching birds. So really looking at visitor spending. You know, people are coming from all over Ohio, out of county. They're also coming from other states. I think that's bad, too. But they're spending money on all sorts of things. Personal, it creates a lot of jobs, right? There's more restaurants along Lake Erie because there's more people coming to watch birds, so that's more jobs. $2 million in tax revenues, $9 million in personal income, $26 million in direct economic stimulus to the economy along Lake Erie from bird watching. Now, if we can have the harmful algal blooms, like in Toledo, across all of Lake Erie, we wouldn't have these outsiders coming here, spending their money. This is an ecosystem service, a very small one, a very specific one. But again, it seems like real money to me. We're also looking at Summit County. So again, they did the same thing. They did it a bit in pieces. They looked at certain things. Stormwater management is very important to Akron, for instance. They're getting fined by US EPA for putting untreated human waste into the river. So they got to deal with those combined sewer overflows like City of Cleveland does. Looking at increased property values, looking at, similar to what we did, is looking at property value and property tax. Much bigger county, more populous, so bigger numbers. So again, health benefits, they quantify health benefits to visitors and regular exercising associated with that. So again, several different parks in Northeast Ohio, several different areas, all kind of trying to do the same thing. Trust for Public Lands did a more comprehensive survey of the metro parks, and instead of, I think it was $200 million, $194 came up with $855 when they started looking at more services provided by the metro parks. Putting that together in kind of a table, you see the Geauga Park District, that $34 million number was kind of the central tendency of our estimate. Cleveland Metro Parks, the first estimate, the second estimate, looking at Summit County, when you add those up, you're in the $100 million range. Ohio, just on bird watching, $37 million. There's also a study done by Costanza, who did the world, also did the state of New Jersey, you know, $14 to $23 billion across the state of New Jersey. New Jersey gets a hard time, but it is the Garden State for a reason. There's a lot of really neat natural areas in the state of New Jersey. Pinelands, you know, really something that's it. It's the only place in the world that they exist that haven't been eradicated. And then, of course, that world estimate that was in the trillions of dollars. So, real money, just because of nature, just because it's being conserved, preserved, and protected. This is what the value of nature is. When you preserve and conserve and protect nature, it doesn't go into a box. It doesn't go into something that suddenly no one has access to, and there's no services to humans being provided by those parks. They are still, obviously, and I hope you get that message, still obviously an integral part of our economy. I mean, forget kind of one of the main reasons why I left the park. I saw a talk in Western Land Conservancy Group, and they had an image of Geauga County, and it was about 20 years apart, and very undeveloped in the first picture. Second picture, the whole western side of the county is extraordinarily developed. You know, driving around Bainbridge and Chesterland and Russell, you see that development. Eastern Geauga County, not so much. But all of a sudden, the fabric of our society in Geauga County is changing. We're going from a rural type of community into a bedroom community with all a bunch of houses, residential houses. So when you start looking at the services provided by the parks themselves, you also have to consider, and I didn't do that, you know, the what-if scenario. Well, instead of undeveloped as providing these services, what if it was a bunch of, you know, homes starting at $300,000 in 3-acre lots? You know, how much resources, government resources, and one thing we agree with everyone, government resources are our resources. There are property taxes. There are sales tax. That's how the government funds things. So if the government has to go in and provide infrastructure and government services to new residential developments, it's you and I paying for it. So we're not only getting all these services from undeveloped land, we're avoiding all these costs by increased infrastructure and government spending, trying to keep up with all this land development that's coming our way. Thank you.
Here for questions. We're all here for questions.
I think we all have to kind of absorb all that. We were told so.
Yes, sir.
Did I hear you correctly at the beginning? You said that the larger corporations like BP and Coca-Cola have had some awakening in regard to the value of ecosystems?
Yes.
Okay.
I mean, for one thing, for example, we do stormwater pollution prevention plans, SWPs. We love our acronyms in the environmental business. And that costs money to make sure that you're not, in these large parcels, not having water go onto your neighbor's property. So having a wetland, having an undeveloped area, all of a sudden reduces how much money these corporations have to spend on infrastructure. I mean, don't get me wrong in that. This isn't like, we love nature because of nature, sort of, you know, altruism. I mean, this is, wow, these are benefits associated with nature. We can take advantage and reduce built, engineered infrastructure by taking advantage of nature.
Yeah, one over here.
Hi.
Is the Dust Bowl phenomenon,
yes and yes and no. Remember, I'm a consultant, so I'm always getting both sides. It definitely could have been avoided. The problem is, you had the economic collapse, so the farmers were not getting as much for their crops as they were. So their answer was to cultivate more and grow more crops. So if you're only getting $1 a bushel versus $10 a bushel, you need to harvest 10 more bushels. That was sort of their thinking. So they completely removed the grasslands. And then we had, which was not man-made, kind of a drought that created conditions that basically, you remember the big clouds, the pictures of the clouds coming over the farmlands. That was all soil being removed from those agricultural fields. Certainly, we have not had it in our country that I know of at that scale ever before and since. Now, when you look at people, I remember it was like Thomas Jefferson, I think, was talking about crop rotation. Things that are kind of obvious now. Part of that crop rotation is to not cultivate fields, to put in some ground cover, to especially lagoons that are going to fix nitrogen, so it's almost like a natural source of nitrogen. So best management practices. So doing agricultural smart has saved money, so increased their profits. But as part of that strategy, it's taking care of nature so nature can take care of us.
If I may, there's a book called Worst of Times about the worst of times. And it's a great history, and it talks about the influence of the farmers and others on the drought. And in part, the drought was caused by the change in the crops. We had 6 foot of grass. We don't have low-growing plants.
Smaller root structure.
And so it wasn't being held in place. Darfur, by the way, is a man-made ecological disaster.
Yes.
Darfur, and that's...
Yes.
Earlier, when you talked about the sewer system in Greater Cleveland, I think it's the Northeast Ohio Sewer and Water District is trying to increase people's rates in order to get that job done at some point, right? Is that?
Yes. I mean, they have to have money to build that. Just like in Burton, my water bill, Burton Village is a bit pricey for water because you have X number of people trying to create that infrastructure, and it's expensive. So.
Yeah, so, I mean, what would you say to, I think it was the city of Westlake and some other cities are, you know, crying foul about these increases in people's water bills, and I'm not sure it's Westlake, but, you know, some of the west side, I believe it's more the west side people who are really whining about
it's exactly the problem that we see over and over and over again. Short-term issues. How's my wallet going to be affected today, tomorrow? Sometimes I even think a month from now. That's about it, you know, what I'm thinking. Versus something that can have benefits over decades, 100 years. So that's where government, in my opinion, has a role. It has to be a voice, it has to take information, it has to present it to consumers in the right way. And despite the ethical issues associated with putting a dollar value on nature, looking at some of these tools to communicate to the public. It is my opinion, present the information to the public will make the right decision. But if it's like, you're going to give me a water, you know, you're going to raise my rates or not raise my rates, if that's the extent of the argument, then it's kind of an easy decision. I'm sorry, let me get someone else first. I'm sorry.
How does climate change enter into all of this, or does it?
Climate change. You're one of those believers, huh? I bet you there's lots of them here. But climate change ain't going to make it better. It's going to make the services provided by nature very important. And quick second on my view of climate change. Climate is complicated. But one thing, several things, that are not in dispute is the greenhouse effect. From a science perspective, it's not the greenhouse hypothesis, it's not the greenhouse theory, it's the greenhouse effect. Life on Earth is not possible without the greenhouse effect. Number one greenhouse gas, water vapor. CO2 is increasing in the atmosphere. No one disputes that. We are changing the composition of the atmosphere because of man's activities. CO2 is a potent greenhouse gas. How is that going to have an effect? I think it already has. I think it's going to be worse. And I think when natural systems have tremendous resiliency, you look at the Gulf of Mexico, that's a, just a boatload of oil dumped, more than a boatload, it's just a huge amount of oil dumped in the Gulf, and those resources are coming back. The resiliency of the environment is phenomenal. Until it's not. And that's a problem. So planning, doing sensible regulation to control it is very important, and certain services from nature are going to become more and more important. You asked somebody 5 years ago in Toledo, how important was the black swamp? Mosquitoes. And that's why the Army Corps, the government, drained the swamps. Mosquitoes. Let's carpet bomb it with DDTs and C-130s. You know, if that doesn't work, just drain it. There was no value placed on the services provided by weapons. Well, now there is. And we see it. You can't take your tap, turn it on, and drink a glass of water. It's crazy. I'm sorry. I'll give you first. I'll come back.
Could it be that humanity is a short-term issue, too?
Wow, man. You're blowing my mind. You know, certainly humans have been on the planet for a relatively short period of time compared to Earth. I hope it's at least another 35 years. I'll take 20 at this point. That's really what always impresses me. Of course, the problem with this is if you look back into, you know, Earth Day, all of a sudden people started getting it. They started understanding it. All those people now are working on Wall Street, as far as I can tell. But if you look at, like, my children are both in college, they're thinking about the Earth in different ways than people my age are thinking about. Most people my age are thinking about the Earth. They're talking about sustainability. What's really interesting, and I think this is a key, they no longer are looking for the bubble in the economy to get rich. They want a good job. They want a job that they enjoy doing, a job that helps people. You know, they're not interested in getting rich. I think this consumptive attitude of, I want to be, you know, rich and move into Hunting Valley or Moreland Hills or wherever, that's just, you know, the hamster on the wheel. If humans can come up with a much more reasoned approach, if we can build up the middle class so people have good jobs, good education, and places to enjoy nature, I think it becomes sustainable. But if humans don't find a way to get it sustainable in a hurry, they're going to have a problem. Companies understand that. So if you're, and I apologize, I do it all the time, so. What if you are whoever this water company is, and you can't get clean water to put in a bottle? All of a sudden, they're starting to look at sustainability issues. They're looking at ecosystem services. They're looking at land that they can buy and leave undeveloped and nurture it appropriately so they can sell us water. This is a big issue. Water is a huge issue for industry. And I think we need to all get on board with that as well. Yeah?
This is sort of indirect, but is the environmental agency in Ohio responsible and trustworthy enough to make a good decision when it comes to that plant in Ashtabula? They're talking about 1.5 million gallons of supposedly okay water that they're going to dump into Lake Erie daily.
Well, yeah, I think the whole fracking issue has probably changed from OPEC's perspective, our perspective, so I don't know how important that plant is going to be. But, you know, they have limits. You know, I think these are people who have good intentions and want to do good things. But let's look at, for instance, that regulatory infrastructure and decision made in Toledo. You know what the legislature solution to Toledo? Don't put manure on fields when they're frozen. Problem solved. This talk is going to be a lot shorter next week. You know? It's like, are you kidding me? First of all, that's stupid. Second of all, that ain't going to do shit. Literally. You know, it's not going to have an effect. But that is what can get enacted. So looking at those sorts of things, the employees of the government can do certain things and they can't do other things. I think the electorate has to get educated on these issues and make it a priority. And then representatives will react to that.
I'm missing what was said over here. I was writing something about water and the price of water, but I had an opportunity 4 years ago to get a private tour of the Barber filtration plant. At that time, this man said to me, one of the reasons our water rates go up in Cuyahoga County is because, and I don't mean to pick on you, so many people are buying bottled water, that in order for the water company, when everybody was just using the water, the rates went down. But we have so many people not using enough water that the rates keep going up. Now that's what he told me. The other thing that was interesting is the chemical lab they have there, how it goes 24/7 to make sure our water, this is the third best in the country, they monitor it, and so forth. I took 4 glass containers, different bottled water, city water, Geauga water, Cuyahoga water, and I had it tested by number 1, 2, 3, 4, and it was interesting. It all tested about the same for me. So it never did anything.
And you know, what's an impurity and what are appropriate levels? I don't believe that statement. Certainly we can talk on a life cycle, you know, beginning to end basis about the value or lack of sale of bottled water. I would agree with many of those arguments. But the reason in Northeast Ohio water rates are going up is population is going down. Infrastructure is getting old. So now we have less people having to spend more to maintain that aging infrastructure. That's why water rates go up. Live in Burton Village and you get it. It's picture clear. You know, we had an opportunity to annex a part of the township and have all these residential folks come in, and people did not like that. It got voted down. But one of the things, if they did that, they were going to update and pay for a new wastewater treatment plant. $5, $7, $8 million, whatever it would have been. Now we have to pay for that. Gallon after gallon after gallon. We have to pay for that. If we're willing to do that, fine. But the water distribution system is a problem. It's 100 and, I don't know how many years old, 50 years old. It's crazy. It's, you know, asbestos pipes carrying our drinking water. You guys know that?
possibility that the oceans, all of the fish and all could possibly implode in the very near future if you heard that just recently?
I don't believe that either. I mean, the resilience of the ocean ecosystem is terrific. I think the, you know, for all we want to say, you know, due to US EPA, due to the Clean Water Act, there's less pollution today than there was. There's the real collapse of fisheries is going to be based on, you know, extraction. So if everyone wants haddock and they start fishing that and it's gone, then that fishery will collapse. But as far as some other thing, and there is some doom and gloom projections of the conveyor belt that's moving heat around the ocean could suddenly stop and that would have catastrophic consequences. It's just too uncertain.
What about the forecast of acidification?
Acidification is an issue, and I think that's going to affect certain organisms. If you're made of calcium carbonate, like coral, and you're increasing the acid, you're not happy. But that's not going to have a catastrophic impact throughout the entire ocean.
That has a lot to do with all the small organisms in the ocean, much of which are exactly as you described.
Right. There's a lot of silicious ones as well. But carbon dioxide in the air plus water, carbonic acid, that's the acidification of the ocean, carbon dioxide.
Plastics in the ocean is an enormous problem. It's an enormous problem.
Yes.
Everybody, thank you so much for being here today. Thank you for